Περνάμε στην ομιλία του Φερντινάντο Ατσαρέλο, ενός από τους κεντρικούς προσκεκλημένους μας ομιλητές. Ο Φερντινάντο Ατσαρέλο είναι καθηγητής μαθηματικών στο Πανεπιστήμιο του Τωρίνο. Ξεκίνησε από τη λογική των μαθηματικών και τα τελευταία χρόνια όλη του η ερευνητική δουλειά είναι στην διδακτική των μαθηματικών. Έχει υπάρξει υπεύθυνος στην Ιταλία για τα αναλυτικά προγράμματα από 6 έως 19 χρονών και τα τελευταία χρόνια είναι υπεύθυνος ενός προγράμματος του Υπουργείου Παιδείας που λέγεται Math Abel. Έχει ενδιαφέρον το Abel από τον μαθηματικό, αλλά είναι ένα ακρονίμιο που σημαίνει μαθηματικά και επιμόρφωση για την εξαποστάσεω και εκπαίδευση. Και προσπαθούν να βρουν τρόπους επιμόρφωση, δηλαδή αφού δούλεψε στα αναλυτικά προγράμματα, δουλεύει για την επιμόρφωση των εκπαιδευτικών, κυρίως στις έννοιες της απόδειξης, στην άλγεβρα και στην ανάλυση. Αξιοποιώντας όμως τα χωρίσματα της διδακτικής των μαθηματικών. Έχει υπάρξει πρόεδρος της Ιταλικής Μαθηματικής Εκπαιδευτικής Εταιρείας. Σε πολλές χώρες υπάρχει μαθηματική εταιρεία και η Ένωση των Εκπαιδευτικών Μαθηματικών. Έχει υπάρξει μέλος της Διεθνούς Επιτροπής του PME, πρόεδρος της Ευρωπαϊκής Ένωσης Καθηγητών Μαθηματικών. Χάρη στην ευγενή προσφορά και ευχαριστούμε τη συνάδελφο Σόνια Καφούση από το Πανεπιστήμιο του Αιγαίου που συμπροεδρεύει. Έχουμε και την ομιλία πλήρη στα πρακτικά μεταφρασμένη στα ελληνικά και τα PowerPoint της παρουσίασης. Οπότε είπαμε ότι θα μιλήσει ο αγαπητός μας προσκεκλημένος στα αγγλικά και παράλληλα θα πέφτουν τα ίδια PowerPoint και στα ελληνικά, οπότε δεν χρειάζεται να διακόπτουμε για να κάνουμε τη μετάφραση. Πιστεύουμε ότι θα γίνουν κατανοητά. Αυτό εξυπηρετεί ακόμη και το ότι στην ομιλία του θα παρουσιάσει και κάποια μικρά βίντεο, τα οποία δεν χρειάζεται βέβαια να εξηγηθούν, γιατί είναι κάποιες μαθηματικές δραστηριότητες.
Good night, everybody. Good night, everybody. I'm sorry I don't speak Greek, so I apologize for that. But thanks to Sonia, you have the translation of all the slides, and I read the slides practically, so there will be no problem, I hope. So thank you, Sonia, and thank you also, the organizers of this meeting, for inviting me. Do you wish to translate? Okay, let's go. So, as you see, the title of this presentation is From Socrates to Sherlock Holmes. I hope you will understand towards the end what I mean. And I underline, there is a second title, Cultural, Cognitive, Didactical Tools for Pursuing the Logic of Inquiry in the Classroom. So the main words are cultural, cognitive, didactical, logical of inquiry. There are some general issues with which I start, and then I'll show you some examples. It depends on the time I have, how many I'll show you. So, let's start with the general issues. I think that some of them have already been addressed in this meeting. And I titled the general issues as follows: challenges and perspectives of mathematical research and education in the internationalized and network era. I start with this image. It was 1999, 1959 in France, the Abbey of Royaumont, and there was an important conference organized by OECD and by ICMAI for reforming mathematics teaching. It was there that the so-called new math was born. Now, in recent years, globalization of economy, universality of technological development, and related needs for manpower skills play the role of strong historical motivation for a reform that should bring to unified standards of mathematics in school, not only in the 34 OECD countries, but in several other countries as well. The 21st century general competences are there. This is taken from some official document. You see, communication, critical inventive thinking, civic literacy, global awareness, cross-cultural skills, and so on and so forth. And PISA has already been mentioned here. And PISA is under the shell of the OECD. And OECD can play again a leading role in this new reform movement thanks to a very important cultural circumstance. The promotion of the PISA initiative, already so influential in many countries, as concerns the change of local curriculum standards in order to meet the challenge of behaving well in that comparative assessment. It was mentioned yesterday by Jambon in the article in the Gora. But, there is a but, very strong but. Remember that the new math was a big failure all over the world. And this failure suggests reflecting on the requirement for a new curriculum suitable to escape the causes of the complete or partial ejection of the new mathematics reform in so many countries. In particular, a reform movement should take into account the existence of different epistemological and cultural positions. As president of ICMAI, I visit many countries all over the world, and I can perceive such strong differences, even if we speak of mathematics. Mathematics is the same all over the world, but when you teach it and when you learn it, it becomes different because the culture that behind it is different. We have to take into account the possible cultural distance of the proposed reform from the mathematical culture of the different countries. The relationships with the culture and the personal contribution brought by the students in the classroom, which are not the same all over the world. So, I don't like to make too many general statements. I made a lot already, and I show you with some examples what I think. Of course, the examples depend on my experience. So, it depends on Italy, on the way I learn and I teach mathematics, and possibly they are not so good for Greece. Each one has to find its own way to mathematics, teaching, and learning. So, let's start. I try to illustrate two facts. There are cultural and cognitive roots of mathematical concepts. And this you have to consider when you teach, and are within you. when you learn. Let me make a very simple example, which illustrates a bit the cognitive side. So, please, let's make this experience together. Please, close one of your eyes, the one you like better. Then, stretch your arm and look at your thumb while gazing a far object. I'm doing that with that lamp there. Then close the other eye and exchange the eye and look at what happens. Looks like this. I look there. Then I exchange the eyes. What have you seen? Your thumb has moved. But it's not so, of course. But it seems that it moved. And this thing, of course, to all people, at all ages, the term generates a surprise. There is an imbalance, to use the Piagetian language. But using mathematics, as you see in the right part, you can explain this curious phenomenon. But this is cognitive, a challenge for people who do such sort of thing. This is the cognitive side that you find behind teaching and learning mathematics. But there is also another experiment you can do with students or with yourself, if you like. You take a globe, some pencils, some ropes, something like that. It has been done with our students in Italy. And ask them to draw the following roots on the globe. The intended meaning is that the roots are the shortest way to go from one place to the other. So there are some things which are not considered. And you have to draw two routes. Stockholm, Cape Town, they have more or less the same longitude. More or less, they are on the same meridian. And the other one is La Valletta, Malta, you know where Malta is. And Tokyo. More or less, they have the same latitude. And the typical answer for question A, the first question, Stockholm, Cape Town, is drawn in the first figure. You see something, it was used with the students. So they draw something which is like a parallel, which goes I'm speaking over, it's wrong, so it's the question about B, La Valletta topic. So they draw that thing which is parallel, like a parallel. But when they try with a rope to check which is the shortest way between Malta, La Valletta, and Tokyo, they find another route, the red one. The answers of these answers of the students have both cognitive and cultural roots, and in fact, the concrete, along with the concrete situation of the classroom, they are crucial for designing a suitable deductive situation. But here is more the cultural. Of course, there is also a cognitive component, but it's more the cultural aspect which are involved. So when you teach, when you learn mathematics, but when you teach, let's think with teachers, you need what is called a priori analysis, which you must consider things both from the cultural and from the cognitive, and also from the didactical point of view. These three things are very important, and you cannot forget any of them. Otherwise, you may risk a failure. And sometimes you can use tools, instruments, in a wide sense of the word, formulas, tools, concrete tools, mental experiments, to support what you are trying to teach. And here is a sketch of the situation. There is some sort of river on the horizontal two red lines, which you have to cross. From the one side, there is the cultural side where you have mathematics, and let's say the mathematics you wish to teach, which is not the same mathematics we find in the journals, in the official journals, something different. We saw yesterday some examples in the speech of Jean Dor. From the other side, you have the activity, the concrete activity, the concrete task you are giving to your students. You have your students, which produce many things. They speak, they write, they gesticulate, they do a lot of things. And they may discover, they make inventions, they use metaphors. This is more the cognitive side. And the didactical situation you are designing tries to cross the river. But the important thing is that there you have the teacher. The teacher is essential for crossing this river. This is the thing. And one thing I would like to say that is that a good teacher with a good design tries to start a virtual cycle which contains such components. And one of the main aspects concerning mathematics, I hope that this will raise some discussion, concerns what I'm calling the logic of inquiry. I'll show you before the end what I mean. But let's think in this way. Students who meet a didactical situation start asking why it is so. Think to the globe, think to the finger, why it is not what I was thinking about. Oh, maybe it could be that other way. No, it cannot be that other way. And so a lot of questions and answers. The logic of inquiry, which we could call inquiry for inquiry, is something which is very important in the class. Otherwise, you have only people who repeat things by rote, which is not so interesting. And your Socrates was excellent in provoking such sort of inquiry. So, but here is something more than Socrates. There is another side, which is Sherlock Holmes, and I come later to that. Using tools as a can be the didactical situation. Look at the center, I put the word tool, I could have written tools also. You need tools to provoke the students in order they answer, they ask questions, they make conjectures and so on. And what you get here is something more similar to an experimental science, in the sense that you are inquiring, you are making experiments. And so there is this experimental dimension which enters mathematics and which creates a dynamic tension between, so to say, the empirical nature of experiences you are doing with your tools and the rigorous, deductive matter, sophisticated formalization typical of mathematics. So this tension, this dialectic can trigger and support the virtuous circle I was speaking before, and to show you something concrete, I show you some examples. It depends on the time I have. How long have I? When can I? I want to finish. Still half an hour. Thank you. So I show you some examples of two kinds. First type. Concrete instruments in concrete environments with their possible emulation in virtual environments, and so this can help digging into mathematical ideas. Dynamic geometry software environments, these can support students to enter into mathematical proofs. Proving is one of the essential things in mathematics. And teaching mathematics has no meaning if you don't prove something. And for mathematicians also, that's true. The organ claim that proves that is a big mistake. So, let me show you an example using this tube. It comes from an old Chinese tradition, but it has a, and it's called the South Seeking Chinese Chariot. And, but it has a deep connections with our culture and with our nowadays environment. In fact, it's connected with mechanical engineering, but it also has deep connections with geometry, particularly differential geometry. Why? You look there at the top left, you find this chariot in front. You go to Taipei, you find in front of the Ethnographic National Museum, you find this chariot. The other things are things that we see all days, some SUV. And the SUV is different from a usual car, because if you go on the mountain or in some ground which is not so nice, you have to use different gears. And sometimes they have different types of gears inside. You see some of them. These gears are also within the chariot, the Chinese chariot. Of course, they were made in a very, so to say, primitive way. Here are more sophisticated things that you find in the cars. But these things are connected with a deep mathematical concept, which was invented many years ago by Tullio Levi Civita, which is the parallel transport of vectors. And I show you in a moment what I mean, but you can illustrate it this way. You take a globe and you ask a student to move a pencil in order not to change, so to move parallel to itself. It's very important. In physics, up to some years ago, it was the way we were supposed to measure things, because we had the champion of the meter in Paris, and then we had to transport it everywhere. Now things have changed, but that is the importance of the parallel transport of things in physics and so on. It's a differential geometry concept that you can illustrate in different ways. Also in this way, which is a carnival. You take a carnival hat and you put on a sphere, a common sphere, and you are something which can be computed using simple trigonometry. You have the line of contact of the cone with the sphere. It has some latitude, let's call it lambda, and you make some computation, which then you take the cone, you cut it, and you splash it on a plane, and you get the figure on the right, and there is a connection between the angle delta and the angle lambda, and the connection is written there. Some simple trigonometry is necessary to prove that, so it can be done when trigonometry is known by your students. But this formula, remember it, it's in the last line, is very, very interesting because it's connected with a lot of phenomena. For example, here you have an image of the Foucault pendulum, and it's connected also with Foucault pendulum, of course. Foucault pendulum is connected with the parallel transport. If you take a pendulum and you make it oscillate at the, and you are not at the North Pole, South Pole, or at the, in the equator, after 24 hours, you see first that the plane of oscillation of the pendulum changes. And after 24 hours, it has not rotated of 360 degrees, but something less, depending on the latitude. And the formula is always the same. Another experiment, very simple experiment with the grapefruit. You take a grapefruit, you see there, you take the skin, then you put down, you cut it, and you splash down, you get again an angle delta. And if you compute the latitude at which you have sliced the skin, you get the same formula. Some easy computation. So this formula is behind a lot of things. And this is the formula. We have seen already it. And I'll show you how the chariot, the Chinese chariot, can be used to produce that angle delta in a very concrete way. I show you a very short video. I hope it marks words. Okay, you take the chariot, you go around the parallel. This is a big sphere, 80 centimeters of diameter. You go on, and then at a certain point you stop. Let's see. Okay, more or less here. Yeah, more or less here. We started there. If you see that the chariot has an arm which is rotating. It's connected in the same way as the your wheel of the car is connected to the wheels on the road. And if you see after a turn, you don't get the arm in the same direction where it was when it started. It was the green direction, now you have the red direction, so there is an angle. And the angle is more or less, it's in perspective, so it seems less than it was. It was 75 degrees, but this is the same formula as before, but now there is an omega inside, because that number indicates the Gauss total curvature of the surface you have turned around. So a lot of things you can show with this chariot, and you can make some computations. It's not the case to enter in them now. And if you use it for Brea, for your Foucault pendulum here in Brea, you find, use that formula, and you find, looking at the computation, that after 24 hours, the pendulum would rotate of 234 degrees, which is called the phase shift. But this thing happens also in very sophisticated physical events. In fact, in physics, it's called the Berry paradox. That's Berry, who invented this. It is connected to a lot of things. It's always the same thing. This is a very interesting cultural factor, which involves a lot of things, mathematics, and which is cognitively appealing. So, now, let's go to, I skip an example here. So let's go here. I change completely the environment. And you know, there are, using a computer, you can use a mouse. But now the new technology has given us the possibility of multi-touch screens. You go on, go on, go on. We skip this. No, 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 no. Okay, here we are. And so there is a big difference if I use a mouse to move things on a screen, or I use my fingers where we have iPad and so on. Cognitively, things are very different. And so it's interesting to investigate how such things, which are cultural things, can influence cognitive aspects and can be used in didactics. Because our students and ourselves are using more and more such things. So you must consider them in some way. I show you a small example. Namely, I try to show you some similarities and differences using the mouse and using this multi-touch environment. So we call the click and drag modality with mouse and the tap, drag, flick, multi-touch with fingers. The usual movements we are using, and our students more than us, more than me in particular, are using with the multi-touch. So let's start with the dragging with the mouse. This is some research of some years ago. I tried to show you an example. I'm using a software, GeoGebra, but you can use any kind of here. So, you ask students to investigate this situation to find something interesting. The inquiry for inquiry. I investigate, I explore. And exploring, that can happen. You move randomly at some point. Oh, you find that the four points of intersections collapse together. That's the first thing, perceptive effect, which is important for students to realize, oh, look here, an aha effect. But after they inquire for inquire, they ask, oh, it's happening by case, or it's possible that I can get it also with other situation, moving this point, see, can I see, oh, it seems that it's possible to have different possible situations. So they can activate a trace and try to move it in order to see what happens. So I don't waste your time now, but I show what after a while they can get. Yeah, you get something like this. Go. Okay, you get something like this. So something which is very bad drawing, but it gives you the idea that possibly there is some circle. Click. Oh, here it is. So why is it so? So the investigation goes on from exploration to some relevant invariant fact to asking why it is so. And you can imagine how things can go on. What has happened here is something very important for dragging practices. Namely, we have two different processes, cognitive processes. The first part is when I look at things and I try to find something interesting, some invariant interesting. So it's like as if I had something which comes from the screen to my eyes, and I call this following researcher in Switzerland an ascending process from the screen to me. I check, I look, oh, what is happening? Let me see. But then, after I find the circle, I have a conjecture. So I have something in mind, maybe, and I check if what I have in mind is validated. Moving in some way things. So my attitude, my modality with respect to what is happening there is changing. There is a descent and a process. And in between the two there is something very interesting, namely, don't look at that other things. Look at that point there. The dummy locus is the circle when you draw it with a trace. It's a dummy because it's not a circle, real circle, but it suggests me to be a circle. And this thing is connected with a conjecture and with a process which was studied by Benjamin Peirce, some years ago, more than 100 years ago, which is called abduction. What is an abduction? It's something different from deduction and from induction. It is something typical in the logic of inquiry. To have abduction means that the process of inferring certain facts or laws and hypotheses that render some sentences plausible, that explain or discover some possibly new phenomenon or observation. It is the process of reasoning in which explanatory hypotheses are formed and evaluated. These are more or less the words of Peirce. And here is the illustration of what happened before. You can keep the four points together, alpha, beta, dragging a vertex along the curve that resembles a circle, and then you have this implication. If the quadrilateral ABCD can be inscribed in a circle, then its perpendicular bisector meet in one part. That's an abduction. So the teaching process consists in trying students to become aware that there are such sort of things, not only deduction, not only induction. If you think to the proof in the school, you don't find abduction, you don't find induction, you find only deductions, which are useless in a sense from this point of view. But that's not what Hogarth meant. And so you can have a production of proof. So this is what is happening using the dragging with mouse. And what happens using multi-touch? Something is changing, and we are studying this. There is a PhD student and some colleague in Brazil. We are studying these things here. We are using a software which is made by Ijima in Japan. It's something similar to Cabri Geometry, to Dynamic Geometry software, but it works really in a multi-touch. If you look at GeoGebra on multi-touch screen, it's not multi-touch, it's single touch. The same for other software. It costs a lot because you must re-elaborate deeply the software. It's not an arrangement as such people have done sometimes. And so we are using that software, which is free. And so we have tried to enter more deeply into this multi-touch way. And what we have found, it's the possibility of designing differently the tasks using what we call a game theoretical approach. And I'll show you what I mean in the next slide. In fact, game situations, think to games in the sense of theory of games, can trigger and support a strategic way of thinking in students, which can promote a process of inquiry similar to the abductive moves promoted by the dragging tasks I've illustrated you before. But this is another approach which puts on the table games. Think to chess. In chess you have the rules, but I'm not able to play chess if I know only the rule. I must know the strategic behavior. behaviors. I can acquire them, paying and so on. So we distinguish these two aspects, strategic rules or strategic principles and the rules. And at school, it's something that happens that it's like if you try to teach to play chess, showing only the rules and not the strategic principle, because the strategic principles don't use deduction. They use also deduction sometimes, but they mainly use abduction, sometimes induction. So that's a more complex way to approach proof in school. And this is the, what I call the logic of inquiry. And the multi-touch screens offer an opportunity to have such logic of inquiry in the class. And so we try to exploit strategies of students in order to help them developing proofs from their arguments, but starting from their strategies. And to promote them, we try to create games, mathematical game situations, not playing games like NIM or I don't know what, but playing mathematical games. Also the other ones are mathematical, but I mean the games which concern mathematics. And we are doing things using geometry, but we are widening it also to algebra and other things. You have two types of situations, cooperative, not cooperative, this is not so relevant now. And here is an example, very simple, a toy example, but we have used it in the classroom. You face two players, Z and Y. Player Z controls the radius of the circumference E on the left through the endpoints of the segment AB. Player Y controls the radius of the other circumference. Y's goal is to catch Z, and Z's goal is to run away. So they cannot go out of the screen. It's on the multi-touch screen. So it's a very simple situation. So the questions typically are like so: when does Z win? When does Y win? Move the centers of the circles to examine possible cases. I have not the time to enter into details. I show you only a few seconds of this movie. And these are two girls at grade nine. We're using such a situation. I'll show you only first a few photographs. There is the translation in English, but look at the... Oh. Happy to play, you see. The movie's go on, but I have not the time. And if someone is interested, I can show you. So I show you how the story goes. The story has two components: the game component and the mathematical component. So the first strategy they are elaborating is running away, which corresponds to the property, geometrical property below. The second strategy is a circle inside the other one, and this below you find the distance between centers and so on. And the third strategy is one center only, which was the way they arrived to solve this situation. And if you look, the upper floor is the game with the multi-touch, and you have an evolution of this. And here is the tablet and the student's feedback. In the flower plane, you have the mathematical theory, and the problem is how to connect them. First of all. And the point, so I skip this part, that, so the point is the following. In the third phase, which is the last one, we have the, what we call the devil's advocate, personified by the teacher or the researcher. He makes questions to students to make them think theoretically what they have found. He insinuates doubts on students' deductions and sentences. And that's like, it lies very much to the student. I skip the phase two, and this is what we call the cycle of the logic of inquiry. Do you remember? 5 minutes, thank you. The logic of inquiry, your students are supposed to ask why D is it is not, maybe it cannot be so, and trying to answer the question. So, questioning develops a specific kind of rational behavior that can help students understanding and producing proofs. And now I come to Sherlock Holmes. Some of you can remember, I've read the Silver Blaze novel. The Silver Blaze, it was a horse, racing horse, which had been stolen from the stables in the middle of the night. And in the morning, its trainer, the stable master, was found dead out in the hall, killed by a mighty blow. And here is what is written in that novel. The inspector is a bit stupid, you remember. And he says, is there any point to which you would wish to draw my attention? Oh, to the curious incident of the dog in the night time, answered Sherlock Holmes. And the inspector, the dog did nothing in the night time. And Sherlock Holmes, that was a curious incident. So, behind that, you can read things according to a logic of inquiry, to questions. Because Sherlock Holmes is in effect asking three questions. Was there a watchdog in the stables when the horse disappeared? Yes. Did the dog bark when the horse was stolen? No. Now, who is that a trained watchdog does not bark at in the middle of the night? It's someone, of course. Elementary idea was. So that's the way you can read things, and that's the way you can have a deductive step in the end. There was a watchdog in the stables, the dog did not bark when the horse was stolen. A trained watchdog does not bark only at his owner. Hence the thief was the owner. So we have this transition from inquiring to proving through abductions. Here I have not the time to enter, there are abductions, and which is this transition. So the logic of inquiry is a wider model than the purely deductive one. It encompasses concrete reasoning and argumentation. And I'm taking this sentence from Jaakko Itikka, a logician from Finland, who was the inventor of this thing in the context of logic, and he says that interrogative inferences are psychologically easier for the human. So I skip this, I speak and have spoken of this already, so I skip because of that. So, what I try to show you in this case is that from Socrates to Sherlock Holmes, cultural, cognitive, didactical tools for pursuing the logic of inquiry in the classroom. So, namely, to train your students to ask why it is not, maybe, cannot be. So, test the logic of inquiry. Ευχαριστώ.